Hi, welcome. My name is Adwoa. Very happy to have you here. I've been working in medical research for over 10 years, and this is basically my open lab book. I document techniques that I'm learning, techniques that I have learned, and just other concepts that are of interest. Go ahead and subscribe and join the study group if you find it of interest.
Now, in this video, we're looking at how a rapid antigen test, also called a lateral flow test, differs from the polymerase chain reaction test. Now, with the polymerase chain reaction test, we are looking at genetic material, so the RNA of the virus, which first gets converted to DNA using reverse transcriptase, and then it goes ahead and it's amplified. This means that if you have only very low infection, you can still come up as positive using the polymerase chain reaction test. When we come to the rapid antigen test, as the name suggests, it's the antigen. So it's the viral protein that's being detected rather than the viral nucleic acid. And so in this test involves a membrane, several membranes that are usually encased in a plastic case so that it's protected, and you go ahead and, judging by the bands that develop on the test, you decide whether you think the person, you think you're infected or not. So let's take a look at how the bands are generated or not generated if you're negative. So you see a sample pot where your sample will go, and your sample is usually a swab that you insert into your nose or into your tonsils area, and you're gonna go ahead and add a solution to it for interaction with the antibodies that are on the cartridge. And so that's the pot where your sample that you've prepared will go. Thanks to the membranes that are embedded on as part of the test, the sample will migrate from the location where you place it towards the end of it. And at each step, different reactions will take place. So we'll go closer and look at what reactions are taking place at each step. If we open the cartridge, what you will find are four distinct areas as part of the test. So initially, where the sample was placed is where you have the sample pad. The sample pad then migrates to an area on this that you can see it's colored, like a purpley reddy color. So this area is really interesting. This is the conjugation area. This place has gold particles. So it turns out that gold particles that are less than 100 nanometers in size, when they're resuspended in solution, usually water, actually appear red. And this property of gold is what's used in this conjugation pad section of the test. So the gold particles are actually negatively charged, and they're able to be conjugated to antibodies that will recognize the viral protein. The antibodies are positively charged, so they can interact electrostatically. And so you are able to have on that section a reagent, a biological agent that will be able to recognize the viral proteins. Downstream of the gold, colloidal gold conjugation area is your test pad. And your test pad is where you're actually going to get an assessment of whether you are positive or you are negative. So there's the test pad area. It's going to have a test portion that, and if that comes up red as a band, then you are positive. But it will also have a control band, and the control band is what's going to be used to check whether the test actually worked, whether the cartridge that you're using actually worked. And so we're going to break each of these components apart and discuss what's happening. And then finally, the last portion is your absorbent pad. And this absorbent pad is actually critical. It acts in drawing the sample from the place where you placed it right to the end so that it can go over the membrane into all the different reaction stages. And so it's like a wicking pad that draws the reagent by capillary action to the end. So this is the lateral flow mechanism that sometimes this kind of test is referred to as. So if we have a look at a sample from an infected person, then when you place it, it will travel along and go to the colloidal gold conjugated antibody section. So this
section is interesting because what happens is the antibody and the colloidal gold will actually move, will be drawn along by the absorbent pad to the test area. So the gold particles, which are red, which can appear red, will actually move along with the antibody until they get to the test area. On the test area, you've got antibodies that are specific to the viral proteins, but this time it doesn't move along. If there are viral proteins in the sample, it will stop at the test area. And as it accumulates, the gold particles accumulate because it's conjugated to the antibody. And so you develop this red line. And the gold particles that are conjugated to antibodies that do not stay at that end because as it's being drawn, there's always excess of the gold particle, will migrate along to the control area. And there also there are antibodies, but this time the antibodies are towards the antibody that was used to recognize the viral protein. So it's not an antibody that recognizes the viral protein, but an antibody that recognizes the antibody that was used to interact with the viral protein. And so you will get a band developed in here. This control band is necessary to confirm, to validate that your assay, that the cartridge is performing as it should. So you need to always have this part coming up as red, because if it doesn't, that means something went wrong and things didn't work as they should. And once again, it's that absorbent pad that's really dragging everything through into the end so that the reactions can take place. Now, obviously, if a sample did not have viral proteins can be nucleic capsid, they can be the envelope of the virus, or the spike protein that will be interacting with the antibody. And so, obviously, if there wasn't any of it, then when it gets to the primary antibody that's conjugated to the colloidal gold particles, none of it will actually interact. And so, you're not going to get a band, but it will keep moving along and that antibody will interact with the secondary antibody that's at the control end, and so you will get the band coming up. And that's how the lateral flow tests or rapid antigen tests work. They're based on antibodies that are embedded on the membrane, recognizing viral proteins and interacting with them and giving you a red band thanks to the colloidal gold particles that are conjugated to the antibodies. Okay, so that's quick video to explain how this works. I hope it was helpful. And if it was, you can go ahead and give this video a thumbs up. And I'll catch you in the next video. Take care. Keep safe. Follow all the protocols. Bye.